friends, and welcome back to our learning series. We are learning Figma as a product person looking to build a lightweight prototype to communicate with our stakeholders, and we are doing just that. Yesterday, Lauren introduced us to the basics of prototyping in our first lesson, and today we are digging in to learn more about the more advanced settings that we have not scratched the surface on yet. So things like transitions, animate, things that I hear about and often tune out because I don't know what they're talking about. Should we start back with the prototype we started with yesterday and build on from there?
Yeah, let's do it. Cool. Let's get into transitions because they're really fun. They're a really great way to elevate the prototype from just going from one screen to another to making it really feel like it's an actual app that you've created, especially when you're doing that testing. So let's pop open our inline prototype view and see what we set up yesterday. So yesterday we just had, when we click on this, it goes to our next flow. Excellent. But if we want to make that do a little bit more, and this is why we'll have our inline open so we can see as we're testing these out. So let's pop back. I just did the arrow keys to get back. We'll go into prototyping mode. So shift E, and we'll open this up to look at our transition. So what we have for options here right now, we're set on instant, but let's check out even something like dissolve. If we did dissolve here and we hit sign up, you can see It was a little bit fading out a little bit more, a little bit more of an easing transition. And we can actually change that. Ease out, ease in, ease out and back, all of these options here. And there's a really great article on the Figma Help Center of what do even all of these mean? And we can change things like how long it lasts. So let's do, This is 300 milliseconds. Let's do 1,000 just to see what happens here. So if we started at our beginning, sign up, you could see it was much longer there. So lots of things that we can play with.
Yeah, and I can see why the inline preview here is really helpful because it allows us to play around with these settings and look what it looks like. This also reminds me of, I don't know if this makes sense, but like slide transitions.
Yeah.
A lot of fun with like slide transitions back in the day.
Absolutely.
It kind of seems like it's more powerful.
Exactly. Yeah, it's like I feel like it's the enhanced like adult version now. We used to change our slides and now we're changing our prototypes. So absolutely, for sure. Let's do a move in and see how that one looks. So if we go back to our beginning, sign up. Move it. It's really slow because we changed that, but we can change it now. Let's go back to 300. And this is a good one for if a lot of screens in your apps are moving in, or if you have something coming up from the bottom, sign up and move that in. So this one I'd say is like a pretty realistic transition to start making it look real.
Yeah.
Smart Animate. Let's talk about that one because that one is one of my favorite ones. So Smart Animate is really helpful in basically saying, okay, Figma, help me out here. I want to go from screen A to screen B, and I want there to be the smoothest transition possible. And what's key here is naming. And I'm going to show you on a new screen just how important naming is. So if we had our screens here, let's grab ourselves two phones. We have this one and we have this one, and we're going to get out of prototyping mode for a second. So shift E, and I'm going to have a rectangle here and I'm going to have a circle. So I'm just changing the quarter radius to make it into a circle here. And I'm going to, actually, I'm going to put this one over here and this one over here. I'm going to change this color to like red, and let's go to blue. And I'm going to say, okay, on my transitions, I did shift E to get into prototype. I want to go from this screen to this screen, and I want to smart animate. So I want to go from here and I want it to be the smoothest transition possible. So when we look at this and we click, it's working, but this could be a lot better if we have the naming correct. So let's take a look at our naming here. On this one, we have it named rectangle one, and this one we have it named rectangle two, which is weird. We should name it circle, but we started out as a rectangle and that's why it turned into a rectangle, or that's why it's still named rectangle. Even if we had it named circle, what's key here is that they're two different names. That's what I want us to look at. And let's just duplicate this so we can compare them a little bit better. When we name this, I'm going to name this just shape, and I'm going to name this one shape as well. This is really going to help the transition because in this one, Figma's doing its best to say, okay, how can I go from this screen to this screen? There's nothing that's named the same from here to here, so I'm going to try my best. But on this one, we've helped it out by saying, okay, we want to go on this screen, shape one's over here. On this screen, shape one's over here. That's what we're trying to transition. So when we take a look at this one, and let's add in our, we have our prototypes added in here. Great. We have Smart Animate. When we do Flow 2 and we look at that, okay, it's fine, but it's not great. When we look at this one, That was way better of a transition there. It's literally, you can even see the color changing from the red to the blue. And that's because we've made sure that we have the naming the same. So naming is huge with Smart Animate if you want to make sure that it's transitioning as best as possible.
Lauren, talk about smart. That's so smart.
It's
It's
so
like
smart.
magic.
So smart. So smart. Yeah. So let's just see what Smart Animate looks like on this one. So if we change this, we're going to change it from Move In. We're going to pop it to Smart Animate. And let's take a look here. If we go from here. Awesome. So it looks similar to the dissolve feature. And a lot of that's probably with the naming, but certain places Smart Animate can be super, super helpful. But screens like this, I think the Move In one would be perfect for what we're looking for here too.
That sounds great. And then I think the next question is when we want to bring in something that's like a menu or something to show on our screen, what are the best options to do that? Because I think the way I've set it up is we have the screen with the menu closed, the screen with the menu open. So I imagine we could just use that as the click, but I'm curious what other options we have on something like that.
Yeah, this one is super fun. And when another way to do this, I got really excited because this is also how I used to prototype, but I would have my starter screen with the drop down right here. But we can actually reduce the amount of screens that you need to use because there is another feature within this prototyping. So what we can do is instead of prototyping from this screen to this screen, we can, and I'm going to get out of Shifty, so I'm back into design. I'm just going to pop this over here. And I'm actually going to delete this screen because what we're able to do is in prototyping mode, say when I click on this, I want to go to this modal here. And instead of navigate to, I'm going to set it to be open overlay here. So when we open this overlay, it's knowing now, okay, I want to open that overlay on top of this screen that I'm coming from. So we don't have to have that background screen, which can be super helpful. In that, especially if you have multiple overlays happening, then you don't have to remember to change everything on this background screen. If you change one thing and then you have to change it on all those other ones, you just have to worry about this one screen and the overlays that you want to happen. So what we can say is open overlay. We know it's going to the drop-down menu and let's put on a dissolve. Sure. Great. And then we can change where it is located here. A lot of like drop-downs might come or like bottom sheets would come from the bottom, but this one we want in a very specific spot. And centered isn't quite going to get us there. We can even take a look at what it looks like right now. When I do next, it's like close, but it's not quite where we want it. So what we're going to do is we are going to set, instead of centered, we're going to say manual. And then it gives this little ghost of up here, and I can show exactly where I want it to be. And now when I click on roll, it's going exactly where we want it. Oh, and this is fun. So this is we didn't do this yet. We've been here the whole time and we didn't do anything. This is an interactive component that's been set up. So basically, if we go all the way back to when we were talking about variants and components, when you create a variant, you can put some prototyping within those variants and publish your design system. And essentially, somebody did that so that these already are working for us. So they've created those interactive components so that we don't need to. That's really helpful for things like these hover states, or for something like a checkbox, or for a toggle that we have to click on and off. Otherwise, we'd have to set up all those screens, but they've done that for us. So we don't even need to set them up ourselves, which is really awesome.
That is like magic, because if someone didn't set that up, I wouldn't have that.
Exactly. So
Like
it's
makes them
really.
so much more polished, which is the power of using those components versus just adding in some text box ourselves.
Absolutely, yeah.
Wow. Okay. That's really cool. Okay. So we set up the separate object that we will have the hover. And then I think the last question is, the next step that I would, and I'm going to do this in our homework, is to connect each of those individual menu options to the screen where the thing is selected. I think from what you've told me is like this is where variables would come in, but can you explain a little bit like how that would work and how we can set this up in a few different ways?
Yeah, absolutely. First off, I know variables can be very intimidating for folks. And variables, basically, how it's helpful here is we're able to set up something that's going to allow us to reduce the amount of screens that we need. But that doesn't mean that you can't do it manually. You can absolutely still set this up by just prototyping those noodles back and forth. But where variables can come in really handy is we could create variables for each of these roles. So we could create a designer variable, an engineer variable, a product variable, and a research variable. And what we could do is we could say, when I click this, set the variable of engineer or of whatever this is to be designer, to be engineer, to be X. So you, so it's just giving you less noodles that you basically have to create from all of those screens. And very similarly to how like we no longer need to have two screens for our dropdown here. We don't need to have four screens for each individual role there. So you can imagine that the more and more screens that you get, the more and more roles that you get, variables could come in really handy there. So you don't, again, have to maintain all of those different screens. But it is a little bit more to wrap our heads around. And since we're doing more beginner stuff here, four screens and just like dragging those buttons isn't too much. So I think we can do that there.
That's definitely what I will be doing in the homework here. Mm-hmm. So I will be just setting up a noodle for each of the dropdown options and then connecting it to the screen and then connecting the buttons of those screens to the screen that I wanted to show when they click sign up. Mm-hmm. Does that feel right?
Yes.
Does that sound right?
Yep. Sounds great.
Okay, yay. Anything else on prototyping? I think we've covered the basics of what we want to make sure to get to. Anything else you would add, Lauren?
One that I remembered was just when you're, so when we're selected on a screen or something, this is what we're seeing in our prototyping view. When I'm not selected on anything, I'm able to see just some kind of some settings in here. And this is a really great place if we did want to change the phone setting. If you're going into your prototypes and you're in your present mode over here, it may not default you to a phone background. But if you wanted to add that in, that's where you could add it in the device over here and pick which frame size you've used to make sure that works. And you can even change things like the model of it, blue titanium. I want to get that one. So we're going to go with that. So just a fun way to make sure, enhance that experience, especially for the user testing.
That's a great call out. I was wondering how the frame got on there. And I imagine that's because I use the default iPhone frame. So cool. But it's helpful to understand that I can change those devices. That's so fun. Mm-hmm. Cool. Awesome. Great. I think that's everything we wanted to cover for prototyping. Again, like everything we've covered, like auto layout, like all the things, there's so much more power we can dig into here. But for our purposes, I think we've covered what we wanted to. Mm-hmm. So we talked about transitions, understanding how to use those and some different options we can set up. Smart Animate blew my mind. Mm-hmm. I cannot wait to try that out. And the key there, Lauren, was naming things to be the same. So
exactly.
Figma understands what's supposed to kind of transition from one scene to the one frame to the next. Is
exactly.
that right?
Yep.
Great. Oh, Lauren, we didn't talk about scroll behavior. Can we quickly just show scroll behavior before we hop off?
Yes, absolutely. Okay, so let's see. If we are over here, so that's actually right over here. So on our right-hand side right here, you can see scrolling. So whether you want it to scroll horizontal, vertical, or both directions, this can be really handy if you have something that does go over the screen. So for example, if you had some cards that are in a carousel or something like that, you're going to want that to be able to scroll from left to right. Or if you had scrolling that where this went beyond the page here, you're going to want to be able to scroll up and down. There's also ways that we can make something right here, decide where it's going to be with the position. So if it's going to scroll with the parent, if it's going to be sticky at the top. So like maybe I want a header to always be sticky at the top, but I want everything else to be able to scroll. So that's going to be really helpful as you do start to build out longer pages to, again, make them more realistic and see how that scrolling works there.
That is very helpful. So if we look at that, like having something like that header there, and if we had like buttons at the bottom, those are the types of things that we would set that kind of scroll to, but then the middle content is what would essentially scroll. Is that how it works?
Yeah. So we would want to set this one to be sticky at the top, but the rest of the screen then could be, and let's actually, if we pop this over and we just take this guy out and say we want to move him down. So we want to make sure he's still in our frame here. So we're popping him into our frame. There we go. We're moving him down.
Yeah.
And now if we open this up, so I don't have anything on scroll yet. So let's go into our prototyping. We want to be able to do vertical scrolling. Yeah. Now we can see, there we go. But the top is, we've set that. I think I just set the green bar, it looks like. There we go. I've set the top to be sticky. We'd probably want to add a background on it. Does it have a background? Let's see. Here we go. We want to add a fill. So now let's see if that's even a little bit better. We've started to add some things in there, but this is again, one of our components, just a couple of things. Oh, you know what? So we probably wanted to add that background in there, and let's make sure that it is, the positioning is right there. There we go. So what I did was, let's go back to that. Let's undo that. Cause that was a handy one. The header was over here. See on my right hand side. And let me just even pull it up too, so we can see it better. The header's at the bottom of my screen, so it's like behind everything else, which is why, even though it's sticky, everything's scrolling on top of it. What I did was hit the brackets to get this to go all the way to the top, send to top, basically. And now when I'm doing this, it's on top of everything, so you're able to see that white again. So that's super handy too, of making sure that as you're scrolling things, everything is in the correct positioning. Oh, and look, another interactive component that we've added in here, which is fun because we didn't do that, somebody else did that for us. This is again why it's great to use those components.
Lauren, this is mind-blowing again. So another reason why that the positioning of our layers is so important there. Mm-hmm. But that's so cool. So how we just did that is we set the header frame to be fixed or sticky, I think.
Yep.
And the prototyping. And then the rest of the frame was scrolling.
Exactly.
Scroll behavior was, okay, vertical scrolling behavior for the rest of the frame.
Correct.
And then that is unreal. It looks like a real app. I can't believe
it. I know. It's great. It's awesome.
Oh, so cool. Okay, I'm going to play around with this a ton. I will come back with our prototype that we're going to share. That's so exciting. And tomorrow we'll talk about sharing and feedback. So again, how to share it, how to make sure it has the right settings for sharing, and then digging more into that commenting and how to enable that for our stakeholders. Awesome. But I think with that, Lauren, we've covered everything we wanted to cover today. So we talked about transitions. We talked about smart animate, which just blew my mind. Then we learned about scroll behavior, which also mind-blowing, so cool. And then learned about some of the other settings that we have for prototyping, including variables, which I won't be using, but it's nice, again, to know how they can be used.
Totally.
So thank you so much, Lauren. I just feel like I'm becoming a wizard, and this is just the basics. So thank Amazing. You so much.
Amazing. Yeah, I'm super excited to see this all come to fruition here.
For sure. I'll bring my homework back. Don't worry. But we'll Amazing. Talk about sharing feedback first tomorrow. I'll cool. see you then.
Excellent. See you later. Bye.
Thank you.